Hello, good morning, everyone, or afternoon or evening, such as it is. How are you? I hope everybody is doing really well and life is good by you and you're staying happy and healthy and warm in the winter, cool in the summer, that things are good by you and that you have peace and love and learning in your life. That's the goal, right? All right. So this week, I'm just looking down at my own syllabus. So this week we're on reform movements and we call this the reform era. And it's a really cool time period because there's a lot of good progressive, there's progressive era. There's a lot of good progressive movements trying to happen. And our big question for this week becomes, what is progressive? What is progress, right? So write that in your notes. So is progress the same as progressive, right? So this is a question that's sort of a hangover from last week when we were talking about manifest destiny and this idea of progress and technological revolutions, and right, the late 1800s, and well, all of the 1800s were this huge booming time, right, of land acquisition, of technological revolution. Remember in the late 1880s, we get electricity, we get sewer systems, we get trains and the railroad, we are starting to create a United States that looks like the United States we have now in the sense of geographical terrain and acquisition of territory. Remember the Louisiana Purchase from 1803 and the Mexican-American War of 1846. Then we're not quite at this point, we're not talking about the Civil War yet. That's next week. But that's right in the middle, right? 1861 to 1865. So we have all of these things happening and they're not without consequences. So there's this idea of progress always meaning for the good. That's the connotation of the word, the feeling of the word is that it's a benefit. Sorry, that's my phone. The feeling of the word is that it's a benefit, right? That, you know, progress, it doesn't mean negative. It doesn't feel negative. It feels positive. So here's my dog peeking in the corner. Hi, Big Red. So I'm going to move him out because you'll just keep looking at him, not paying attention. He's so cute. So what we're talking about is this, what is exactly progress and who, here's the big questions, who gets access to progress, to this progress? Is it always progressive? The progressives like to tell you that it's progress and that it's progressive and it's good for all. Is it? Who is using the railroad? Who's building the railroad? And then who's getting to use it, right? So we'll answer these questions later on. So let's just keep in mind, what's progress? Is it progressive? Who gets access? Question number three is, who gets access to that progress? Who gets to use it? Are the same people who are building the nation and building progress, are they the same people that get to access this progress, right? So maybe not, yeah? So I just want to give you a little tour here. I'm just going to pause this for a second and get my books in order. All right. So before we go any further, I just want to have a little show and tell. This is a glimpse into my library, a glimpse into my world here, and a glimpse into where my sources are coming from. So that by now, by week four of this History 102 class, you can see where I'm getting my information. So of course it's from Remini, right? Our textbook. Wait. From Remini, our textbook. It's also though, from a lot of other sources of work that I've been doing for, 20 or 30 years. So one of them is How Blacks Built America. And this is a really good book to see just a lot of stuff. I'm just going to go through the books. I'm not going to give you a summary of everyone. Guarding the Golden Door. This is about immigration. And then connected to immigration, is the construction of whiteness, which we'll also get to, but whiteness of a different color, how European immigrants became white because they weren't considered white in the beginning. And this is the sort of Bible of the Trail of Tears. This is the book that all scholars use really to talk about the Cherokee Nation and the Trail of Tears that we talked about last week with Manifest Destiny. And sort of the creation of the United States as an identity, as a nation state, as an empire. It wouldn't be an empire without two things. One, native removal, right? And genocide. And the taking of Mexico. So we have The Trail of Tears by John L. and El Norte. I haven't finished this book. This book is huge. I haven't finished this one yet, but I read it in little parts. The Epic and Forgotten Story of Hispanic North America. So this one's really great, and you can see how it's chock full of information. The other book that I really swear by, if this is interesting to you in Native American studies, is Killing the White Man's Indian. This is probably one of my favorite books and one of the first books that I ever read in college, specifically about Native American identity, and by Fergus Bordowich. And it's life-changing. Also, a book that I teach a lot when I teach at Philadelphia University or Jefferson University now, when I teach the American diversity and immigration classes over there, I use A Different Mirror by Ronald Takaki. And it's a history of multicultural America. So it's like a really in-depth, multi-layered historical analysis. And Takaki is just a genius among historians. So here's my sourcing, here's my background, my information, where I'm getting my information from. Okay. So I just want you to know, just in case people are like, where can I get more information on this? Or for people who are, you know, saying, what are your sources? This is really interesting material, or I don't believe you. What are your sources? Those are my sources. Okay. So coming along from the Haitian Revolution, where Toussaint l'Ouverture, I do it with the as I speak Spanish, not French, but for any of my French speakers, you can say it properly. I'm terrible at it. Toussaint l'Ouverture, I don't know how to say it. Leading the French Revolution is really important because he was enslaved. He overran the French, and he ended up becoming and creating the first Black sovereign nation. And it was really important for Black peoples, right, globally. It was also really important for the United States and for Black enslaved peoples in the United States to say, look at that, right? Look at what just happened there. And can we do that? Is that something that we can start thinking about? And we'll talk more about that when we get to slave revolts. We'll spend a whole time on we did daily resistance acts, and we'll do like Nat Turner and John Brown and like big slave revolts later on. So the difference between Toussaint and Andrew Jackson is Toussaint, I'm calling him by his first name only because I cannot pronounce his last name properly, is that they just both come from humble beginnings, but of course Toussaint was enslaved. And Andrew Jackson, coming from an impoverished background, ends up becoming a wealthy person, becoming president of the United States, a leader just like Toussaint. But the difference is, of course, is that this moral divide on what we do with that power, right? And it's sort of the divide that we look at now. What do any of us do when we've come from humble backgrounds or any kind of oppression at all, religious, racial, gender, class, sexual orientation, religious, right? Any kind of background of oppression and marginalization. And then get some power, some modicum of power, whether you become president, whether you become Jeff Bezos and, you know, own Amazon, which is this monopoly, a business monopoly. We'll talk more about when we get to big business in like week 7 or 8. What happens though? And what divides people when they get that modicum of power? Do they retain their roots? Do they remember their version of oppression and use it to help other people throw off the shackles of oppression, like Toussaint? Or do they take that power and say, now I get to make all the decisions, right? Now I get to enslave other people. Now I get to create Indian removal, right? The Indian Removal Act of 1830, that's what I'm gonna do with my power. I'm not gonna, so Andrew Jackson says, I remember my humble roots and I'm gonna do what with it? I'm gonna create the Indian Removal Act. I'm gonna create layers of oppression. I'm gonna be one of the most racist presidents that the United States has ever seen. And there's a lot of racist presidents. And sexist presidents and homophobic presidents, right? And Islamophobic presidents. So this idea that Andrew Jackson can't create empathy and connection between his socioeconomic oppression and someone else's racial and socioeconomic and psychological oppression, Native Americans and Black enslaved, right? Peoples, is something to explore, right? It's something to look at historically. It's something to say, is he just a product of his time? He can't create more progress because he's, you know, locked in his time period. I don't know. What do you think, right? What do you think? And I keep coming back to John Adams and John Quincy Adams, who refused to have slavery in the White House. And when you've got the sixth president refusing to bring slaves into the White House, and then you have the seventh president creating the Indian Removal Acts, can you argue that Jackson is just a product of his time? I don't know. I'm going to leave that open for you. Okay, so the Jacksonian era, one of the big things in Remini is that it ends on this idea of a question, the question, and how marginalized peoples are a question of what to do with marginalized peoples, right? So it's called the slavery question. And later on, it's called the woman question. James Baldwin famously sort of reiterates this idea of the Negro, excuse my language, Negro question. And in James Baldwin's words, I am not your Negro and I am not a question, right? Has everyone seen this documentary? I Am Not Your Negro. It's on Netflix. It's brilliant. It's really just trigger warnings. It's a lot. I mean, it's all about race and it's a lot of N-word and just a lot happening, but it is life-changing. I Am Not Your Negro. It's a documentary about the life and philosophies of James Baldwin. Brilliant. It's life-changing, life-changing. And so, you know, James Baldwin famously saying, this is not who I am. And why do you need me to be this person, right? He uses the N-word, but I am not this, you know, marginalized person. I'm not the N-word. Why do you need me to be that? Why? What about you needs me to be inferior to you? Do you only get your superiority from making me inferior? That's bullying, right? That's oppression. That's domination. That's patriarchy. It's racism, right? It's all these things. So it's not me. Why are you telling me I'm the Negro question or women becoming the woman question? What do we do with these women? Right? Like, when did I become a problem for you to solve? Right? It's this really kind of fascinating construct of marginalization and what happens to these like layers of oppression, right? It's layers of oppression. It's the system, it's the education system, it's the prison system, it's how people are stereotyped in the media. And this is all true from the 1800s on, right? The political cartoons of the 1800s are social media, right? Which is the first kinds of social media. All right. So we are going to go into the modules. Now that's the prep. That's the prep from this week of manifest destiny and oppression and native genocide, cultural genocide, and physical genocide, right? It's the purposeful killing of one specific population. That's genocide, right? That's Hitler and the Jewish genocide. It's the Dutch and Anglos and enslavement as a genocide, right? It's the purposeful killing of a peoples, yeah? And so the Indian Removal Acts, I think, count as a form of genocide. You're making people walk thousands of miles in the winter. You know they're going to die, so that's a kind of genocide. There's also cultural genocide and cultural imperialism. And that's the appropriation of someone's culture. It's taking their culture and taking their livelihoods, their lives, their families, like enslavement, tearing apart families, the selling off of children from their parents, putting married couples or partnered couples, because marriage was illegal, partnered couples on different plantations. That's a kind of cultural genocide. You are purposefully breaking apart the Black family, the Native family, right? That's a cultural genocide. You're trying to kill their culture, and family is a part of culture, right? And language, like forcing people to speak English when that's not their language, when their language is Cherokee. It's forcing people to become Christians when their indigenous religion is Yoruba or paganism, right? All of that counts as cultural genocide. You're killing the person. And very famously, Colonel Pratt, who was part of the Native genocide, said, kill the Indian, save the man. So it's their idea of assimilation, forced assimilation, and they do that through forcing people to become Christian, forcing people to wear Anglo clothing, you know, forcing people into the system of capitalism if they were in shared communities before that, right? Breaking apart the family structure, outlawing marriage, outlawing reading and writing, right? Okay. All the things. All right. So let's go to our module this week. That's how last week feeds into the reform era right now. All right. So let's go to our module. So here's the reform era. So this is reform era and revolutionary acts. So normally in a 15-week class, I have these two separate. So I do reform movements, and then in another week, I do revolution and how people, marginalized peoples who are being oppressed by the government and society at large, have large resistance acts. So not just the Igbo landing mass suicide or daily resistance acts where they impact themselves in order to resist societal oppression, but how people create external revolutionary acts in the sense that they're like outwardly, African-Americans are killing white folks. Native Americans are killing white folks. They're siding with the British, right? Remember, the enemy of my enemy is my friend. So Native Americans siding with the British to fight the Americans, right? The Anglo-Americans. All right, so we're looking at these large revolutionary acts. So again, this is a lot. It's a lot for 1 week because we're in an accelerated class. So just keep that in mind and keep that going. Just keep the momentum going. So here's our three reform movements: temperance, abolition, and suffrage. They don't go in any particular order. In fact, time period wise, it's temperance, suffrage, abolition is the chronological order there. But so this is in your module. So here's the reforms themselves. So abolitionism and abolitionists are the people. The abolition itself is the movement for the freedom of African Americans in enslavement. So it's seeing the South and their beliefs and perpetuation of enslavement, Black enslavement, as opposed to Native enslavement, Black enslavement, as just morally reprehensible, as anti-Christian, as just antithetical to human rights, right? I've seen, so there's a lot of really staunch Christians, primarily the Quakers, and we love the Quakers in Philadelphia. Philadelphia is a very, very, very Quaker town. We still have a number of Quaker schools and, you know, they call themselves Friends, the Friends meeting houses, and it's, the Quakers are alive and well. Of course, there's Quaker Town a couple miles from here. And the Quakers were probably the number one. If anybody ever asks you, did Christians fight against slavery? You would just say the Quakers. They're Christians. They believe in the Christian Bible and they hated slavery. They thought it was the most inhumane, anti, you know, God, Jesus, Christian Bible thing. And they helped run the Underground Railroad. They put their own lives at risk. Many Quakers died for the anti-slavery cause. So that's abolitionism in a nutshell. And its primary proponents were the Quakers. And the reason I'm sort of shouting out the white abolitionists is because abolitionists were often white. And why is that? Why? I mean, obviously all Black folks were abolitionists because they wanted to end slavery, but why would we spend a few minutes focusing on white abolitionists? Right. So one of the reasons is because, they had the access and they had the privilege, they had the agency to run parts of the Underground Railroad where African Americans weren't allowed to be that above ground person who could be seen. So white abolitionists were a really pivotal part of ending slavery. It wouldn't have been possible without the Quakers. And it's really important to shout out allyship and what that looks like, because they were the ones that could use their white privilege as a weapon for good, right? Not as a weapon for evil, like being a Karen, right? That's weaponizing your white tears, weaponizing your white privilege for bad, right? For yourself. This is the case where it's weaponizing white privilege for the good, right? So we just want to give a shout out to the Quaker abolitionists for their work and their, you know, sacrificing their lives for the right side. And then of course you've got the Black abolitionists who were just everywhere and really using their freedom or their enslavement to really pivot that right. So we have people like Sojourner Truth, who's the first woman to really stand up in public places, which was almost impossible for this intersectionality of Blackness and womanhood, right? So this intersection of a triply oppressed, right, identity, and that she stood up and said, you know, Black women are, she was the first Black woman publicly to say in the 1840s, Black women are being treated horrifically. We're not allowed womanhood. We're not allowed to access equality with Blackness and Black men. We're being left out of everything. And she was just incredible. So from Sojourner Truth to Harriet Tubman, who you'll read about in your readings this week in Remini, and her role in being one of the most famous conductors of the Underground Railroad. So then we have, so abolition is, I think we know a lot about abolitionism because we know all the freedom fighters, the really famous ones. You've learned about them in high school. Learned about them in even college. It's something that we've talked about. Before we get to Temperance, let's just talk about the women's rights movement really quickly. So that's down here. So the first way that we see women's rights, again, publicly, these things are being fought. Anti-slavery, anti-women's oppression have been fought behind the scenes for, you know, centuries, right? Hundreds and hundreds of years. But it's rare that you actually start seeing people in public. First of all, because African Americans weren't allowed in public. They weren't allowed to be in groups. They're being oppressed and marginalized in every single way. It's illegal for them to read and write, that kind of thing. The same for women. So women were not allowed to be in the public sphere. They were relegated to the private sphere. They were told they had to be domestic angels. It was called the angel in the house. And their job was, if you were born with a uterus, you were just meant to have babies, and people used the Bible to support that. breed and be prosper, or something from the Bible, right? And so people sort of weaponized their Bible, they weaponized religion, they used patriarchy, male oppression, male domination, and people just took it and ran with it, right? So the fight for women was a fight fought on many fronts. And one of them was in the house, trying to convince their husbands to let them have the vote, trying to raise their sons to be, you know, not wife beaters, right? To trying. You can read letters. There's a lot of letters published from Abigail Adams to John Adams, you know, really arguing. She's arguing with her husband and the president, and arguing for women's rights and women's emancipation. Let women go to college. Let women be educated. We aren't even at let women have birth control, so they don't have to have 6 and 7 and 10 kids and die in childbirth and have their children die from starvation, and really wanting to give birth control access in some way, having any freedom or say around their bodies. None of that existed, right? So women are being forced to have just tons of children, and would then watch them die from starvation. So just think in your minds, women's rights at this point is women don't have the vote in the 1800s. Every time we have sex, we're getting pregnant. There's no healthcare, there's no welfare, there's no healthcare access, there's no birth control access, there's nothing to support women. There's nothing to support women in becoming whole and becoming healthy and becoming strong and becoming good mothers. There's nothing to support women at all, right? So suffrage is the word you're going to hear a lot, and that's right here. Suffrage is very specifically women's right to vote. It just means women's rights to vote. But so when we talk about women's rights in general, we're talking about that women can't have a bank account without their husband or father's permission, or at all. The husband or father would own it. They can't own property. They can't do anything to give themselves economic emancipation, to give themselves financial freedom so they could have a life of their own. Their entire lives, our entire lives, are subjected to our husbands, our fathers. If both of those people die, it's your brother. Sometimes in multiple cases, it becomes your son. So I can be 50 years old and my 10-year-old son can have signatory power over me, right? Just, you know, really difficult life at that point, right? And then of course, for women of color, it's just multiple burdens there. Yeah, the intersectionality of that. So the Seneca Falls Convention was the first, 1848, was the first time that women gathered publicly. Of course, women have been behind the scenes doing this for a long time, but the first time they gathered publicly to really push back against women's status as second-class citizens. Now, mind you, this is a very white woman's movement, right? This is first wave feminism, and it's focused just on women getting the vote. But because abolitionism is also happening, so abolitionism is looking for freedom for African Americans exclusively, not Native Americans, not Asian Americans who are trapped building the railroads. Abolitionism was a very Black-centered movement. The women's rights movement was a very white-centered movement. And in part of that is because white women knew how to read and write. White women had been given the power and privilege of being married to these white men, to have education, to have money, to be able to leave the house. They're not working. They're not being forced into domestic labor, sweatshop labor. And so the movement is by rich white women, because they have the time on their hands, they have the freedom of movement to be able to leave the house and do that and not work and do that. The problem is, just like when we get to Jackson Katz is another, this domestic violence worker. When we get to Andrew Jackson, it's like, do women recognized that their sisters of color are suffering insurmountably more than them, and, you know, give a hand to hold to lift them up and say, you should be a part of suffrage too. Let's make a seat at the table. Let's make some room and power share. Do they do that? No, right? They don't. A lot of white women in the movement are really racist. They don't invite Black women to the women's marches. They make them, if they do invite them to the women's marches happening on Washington in the 1800s, they make them stand at the back. It gets so complicated, right? But it's not complicated. It's just racist. So we have these movements where there's Black freedom over here, but it's mostly centered around men. We have women's movement over here, but it's mostly centered around whites, white women. So then Black women are in the middle. And here's Sojourner Truth's argument, Ain't I a Woman? Sojourner Truth saying, I'm not given equality like a Black man, even though I'm working as hard as a Black man, right? I am working all the same hours. I'm working in the fields. I'm doing everything a Black man's doing, but I'm paid half as much. I'm seen as half a person. Then when, as a Black woman, I say, okay, so forget that. I'm going to go to the women's movement. Then what happens to me in the women's movement is I'm not allowed anything that's being told to me that's womanhood. I'm not being allowed to keep my children, which is motherhood and is held up as what I'm supposed to be doing as a woman. I'm not allowed to stop working, which you're telling me is a sign of womanhood, that I get to stay home and take care of my children and be a wife. I'm not allowed to be a wife. I'm not allowed to be a mother. You're selling my children for me. You've outlawed marriage for me. So the white women are not accepting me as a woman. So I'm stuck as a Black woman. Sojourner Truth is saying, I'm stuck in this limbo. My Black man is over me. The white women have totally forgotten me as part of being a woman. And I'm left out of everything and I'm not given any rights. And I call bullshit, right? So Sojourner Truth's speech, Ain't I a Woman, in the 1840s, is the first time we see publicly and in print a Black woman calling out intersectionality and saying, everyone's pushed me to the side. And it's wrong on every level, on every level. And of course, don't we still see this today, right? How the women's rights movement leaves Black women out, how hashtag Me Too and Time's Up has left Black women out and all women of color out, that becomes a white centric movement. And then how we see in like the Black Panthers in the 1960s and 70s, Black women being treated as second class, right? The Black Panthers are fighting for Black rights, but then they're saying to the women, can you go get my coffee? Right? Like nobody's, Black women still aren't winning throughout history. And how do we figure that, right? What's progress? Who's getting access to progressivism, right? Okay, so that's women's rights. And just keep in mind, women of color versus women's rights and abolitionism versus Black women, right? Who's getting allowed to do what there? Now, the third one is temperance. And this is the movement you probably haven't heard about as much. So temperance is when mostly women, mostly white women, are fighting for the abolishment of alcohol. Alcohol. And why? I'm not going to answer this one for you. Why did women who are stuck in the home, not allowed to go to college, not allowed to vote, not allowed to do much of anything, why are they fighting for getting rid of alcohol? Maybe they should have been fighting to drink more for themselves, but they weren't allowed to drink, right? So that's an answer. That's a question for you. That's something I want you guys to answer. Why is temperance, which is a very under the radar kind of reform movement. Everybody knows about abolitionism. Everybody knows about suffrage. Temperance was the third big one. It was huge. And why stop drinking? Shouldn't we drink more? Just kidding. Okay. So those are your reform movements, and everything is here. So here's your, this is the first age of reform. It goes through abolitionism, colonization, anti-colonization, women's rights. And then of course, here's the temperance movement. There's my sources. There's women's suffrage. This is the actual women's suffrage acts and charters that are being put forth, because remember we always want, as historians, primary source documents. Here's abolitionism. And we just want to know these folks' names, like William Lloyd Garrison. And we want to know the people who are the most popular, or the popular, like the coolest, but, why is that true? Why are these people the leaders of this? What about William Lloyd Garrison, who's a white man? Why is he, you know, giving his whole life up for abolitionism? And these are really good questions to ask, right? So I love this image because it puts everything together: suffrage, anti-slavery, which is abolition, and temperance activism. So here are primary source documents and primary source images. I really love photography. I really love art. And so I'm always going to give you images that I think a picture says 1,000 words, and, you know, lips that touch liquor shall not touch ours. Again, why was temperance such a big movement? And here's suffragettes. And then here's abolitionism. And there's Sojourner Truth. Here is the Ain't I a Woman speech, or one version of it. And then here's womanhood. So we're going to focus a little bit here on womanhood and on Black womanhood, which is not the same as white womanhood, especially at this time period. So coming off of the Ain't I a Woman speech, you know, ain't I a woman? Like, who is allowed womanhood? What does womanhood look like? For whom and why? And this is also sort of your next level question. So these are like history 101 questions. You know, next level history 201 would be appropriations of womanhood. Why is the United States called she? You know, why is Lady Liberty a thing? And it's a really interesting question. So here's an article on when America was female. And all these pictures didn't come up. Well, I'll put them back. I'll go through and do it. Okay, so now moving on to abolitionism. Here is, I just wanna put this because in March of 1857, we had the largest mass scale sale of human beings in the United States. And it was called the Weeping Time. And it was a really traumatic event. And I don't know why people don't talk about it more or teach it more. Same with Ebo Landing. It's a really big deal that, you know, 75 enslaved peoples from Africa revolt and take over a ship and then commit mass suicide. This is a huge deal. The Weeping Time is also a huge deal. That, you know, hundreds and hundreds of African Americans, enslaved African Americans, are sold through a legal process is a huge deal and needs to be talked about more. So we're going to focus on that for abolitionism. And we're also going to focus on the fugitive slave laws. So one of the things that becomes really problematic that we'll talk about, that this is leading us into the Civil War, is this idea of the fugitive slave law. So here's a primary source document. This is an actual flyer. It's an actual poster that was put out. And it's warning the African-American peoples, free or enslaved, of the kidnappers and slave catchers. So we'll talk about this a lot more, but one part of the abolition movement that's really important and resonates really intensely today are the fugitive slave laws. And the fugitive slave laws of the 1850s and way before that, but, you know, the legalized mandated laws of the 1850s say that a fugitive slave, so a runaway slave, or someone who has fugitive meaning, right, has run away in any, under any circumstances, whether they're being tortured, whether they're, it's self-defense, like it doesn't matter, right? If you're enslaved and you're owned by a person, then, and you leave that plantation without your pass, without your note, right? You would literally, as an enslaved person, need a pass. And any white person walking down that road can stop me and say, where's your pass, right? N-word, where's your pass? Who do you belong to, right? That's how I'm talked to if I'm African-American in the South. And then the fugitive slave laws say, this happens in the North too. It's not that you step over one state line, a slave state, into a free state. You step over from Virginia, who broke off into West Virginia to be free, to say, right, Virginia broke apart because they disagreed on, you know, enslavement. And I don't step across the Ohio River, which was the thing to do, to get across the Ohio River. And now I'm free. I'm good. I'm solid. I am on solid, free territory. That's not the case. So the fugitive slave laws that were passed say that slave catchers, which became an actual job, slave catchers can go onto any territory at any time, under any circumstances, to capture a fugitive slave. Okay? So the fugitive slave laws were one of these tipping points for abolitionism, where the abolitionists, white and black and everybody, the abolitionists said, this is bullshit. This is insane. If someone makes it to a free state, they are free and we will protect them, right? And the South said, no, that's my property. I get to reclaim that property no matter where it is. Right? So if you're a racist slaveholder in Missouri and you believe that that person is your property, like a phone, like your, your property, then wouldn't you be able to go into someone's house and be like, you've got my phone? Right? That's how the South thinks. That's how slave catchers think. That's how plantation owners think, slave owners think. These people are property to them. They don't have souls. They don't have humanity. They don't have rights. The abolitionists are like, you're insane. That's absolute insanity. Of course they're human. Of course they have rights. Of course we're all equal. Even if people, you know, at the time didn't think they were equal, they were equal enough. And especially for the Quakers, in the eyes of God, they are human beings and have souls. And especially if they've become Christian, they have the right to go to heaven and they have the rights to be protected. And right, it's a whole Christian argument layered on top of an abolitionist argument. So we're going to look at a case study that is really, really complicated. So here's the fugitive slave laws. So what we're arguing about the fugitive slave laws is, what did the North do about this, right? We know the South. We know the South's position. They fought the Civil War in order to be a separate country, in order to keep slavery. So we know the South's position. We know that the South is willing to die in the Civil War to keep a whole population of people enslaved. They fought for 4.5 years for that right and lost the war and still wanted to keep slavery, right? Still wanted to secede, right? Secession, meaning to separate and become their own country. Remember, when we get to the Civil War next week, the South had their own president. They were not a part of the United States, right? And we'll talk about this more later. Again, next week in the Civil War. I don't know why this isn't working. My internet's not great. People are calling, Republicans, particularly Marjorie Taylor Greene, are calling for secession now, didn't she? Just last week, she called for civil war. So people of the South are still wanting to secede, right? So please, please, please read this handout. It's only a couple pages long and it's brilliant. It's really, really well done. It's a PDF. You can print it. So here's this, the famous thing where the North is saying, look out, like, look out, colored people of Boston, right? Of course, we don't say colored people anymore, but people of color of Boston, like, look out, right? Watchmen, police, kidnappers, slave catchers are coming for you. So, so here's, just, you know, do this reading. Okay. And then there's all sorts of, sources, and it's just really a good, good reading. So there's your primary source document, because we're fancy schmancy historians and we use primary source documents. Okay. Now here is your discussion post and your assignment for this module. We're going to be focusing on the intersection between race and gender. And we're going to do that through the case of Margaret Garner. So I'm not going to answer any of these questions, because this is what you're going to do in the discussion. And please do not answer all the questions. Then you're keeping room for other people to be able to have some space to breathe, right? So this is my, please do not answer all the questions, leave room for others, but answer some of them. So I've given you a whole bunch of prompts here. So here's, you know, if you are more interested in art, then let's look at the painting, what's being depicted here. And then what are the two sides of Margaret Garner? And what are the legalities? What does her case represent? How is it systemic racism? How is it looking at the legalities or illegalities? Okay. So now I'm going to tell you a quick short story here. So this is the case of Margaret Garner. She was an enslaved Black woman living in a slave state in the South. It's a very complicated case. I'll post a video. You can get into the details of it. But in order to shorten this video, all I'm going to say is she, her husband and her children, you can see three of her children here. One, two, three. That might be a fourth. I have to go back and remember, but you can see her children in the photo. And what happens is that she's enslaved. She sees no end to slavery. She says, I'm going to, you know, go use this Underground Railroad. I'm going to cross the Ohio River. I'm going to go from a slave state to a free state. She's being helped by Quakers. She's being helped by abolitionists. She crosses into freedom with her children. But because of the fugitive slave laws, slave trackers and slave catchers follow her into the free territories. They corner her in this shed. She's in like a shed. She's hiding. And she is trapped. Okay. So picture yourself, you're a Black mother, you're technically enslaved, but you're on free territory. You are just cornered. There's no way around that you are going to be caught. You are surrounded by slave catchers, the police, right? What is the first police? Margaret Garner, I'm just going to tell you the fact, and then your job is to interpret it. The fact is that Margaret Garner slit the throat of one of her children. She starts to kill her other child. She has other children screaming and crying, the police outside and the abolitionists on the other side. The police bust down the slave catchers, they weren't called police yet. The slave catchers bust down the door. They stop her, right? They like take her weapon, the knife. And everybody points fingers. And this is the painting, right? This, I'll show you a big image of it in 2 seconds. And everybody is pointing fingers at what she has done. So here's your big question. Why is it that everybody is pointing a finger at this situation and making it justify their point of view? All right, so I'm going to show you the painting, and I want you to write these questions down. They're also in the discussion, but write it in your notes. How is it that this situation of Margaret Garner killing her children, that's just a fact, killing her children, that her children, some of her children die at her hand? Why is it that the abolitionists, the freedom fighters, say, look what you made her do? And why is it that the racist Southern slave catchers say, see what she did? And everybody in the North and in the South, in the white community, in the Black community, everybody starts using the Margaret Garner case as evidence to support their beliefs. Why? So now take a look at the painting again. You see everybody pointing fingers. The abolitionists, the slave catchers, Margaret Garner. See the fingers? See the hands? So you can come at the discussion in multiple ways. You can deconstruct the painting. You can say why the slave catchers in the South are using this as evidence for their beliefs, to support their beliefs. Or you can use it as deconstruct in your post why abolitionists are using this moment to say that their cause is the correct one, the right one. Or you can tell me what you think Margaret Garner's saying, right? What do we think Margaret Garner is saying, right? You can see her sort of, everybody's mouths are a little bit ajar. They're all sort of saying something. What is each person saying? In this case, what is Margaret Garner saying? What are her children saying? What's happening here with her children? Or you can come at this painting from cultural imperialism standpoint, use the vocabulary, use it as, does anybody want to become a lawyer or human rights lawyer or civil rights lawyer or paralegal? What are the legalities here? What are the legalities? She's on free territory. Does she get arrested for murder? Is she in violation of laws? Is she still enslaved? Then it becomes the slave owner's responsibility. Is she a murderer? If she's property, is she a murderer? Don't you have to be considered a human being to be a murderer? A table is not a murderer, right? So then all of a sudden, what happens when the slave catchers are saying, she's my property? Then can you try her for murder? Can you have it all the ways? Really complicated case, a really horrifying case, a really, really devastating case. That's your discussion post. Again, trigger warnings for Black violence, right? Violence against Black peoples. Systemic violence, legal violence. There's just so much happening here. It's really difficult, but it's really important that we confront why this case was on the front page of newspapers in the North and in the South. How is everyone taking Margaret Garner's case and manipulating it for their own purposes? And what happened to Margaret Garner, right? What happened to Margaret Garner? What happened to the rest of her children? What happened? And why did this happen, right? Really, why did this happen? Okay, so big discussion. That's why this video is so long this week. It's a big discussion. And again, remember, I usually break this into 2 weeks. We usually have just the reform movements, Temperance, abolition, and suffrage in 1 week. And then we have these like fugitive slave laws and Margaret Garner case in another week, right? So this is where we get accelerated. This is where we start getting accelerated. Okay, so the Margaret Garner case is really just difficult and upsetting. It's just a lot, but it's important. So here's your questions, here's your prompts. And so here's the main prompt, but you can come at this from one perspective. Again, please do not take up all the space in the room and answer every single question that I'm asking. You're taking away from other people, right? Let's just pick like one point or one perspective or one thing. Or the intersectionality question, right? How does Margaret Garner case represent the intersectionality of the women's movement and its success and failures and the anti and pro-slavery movement? So you can look at one part or one question. Okay. Okay. Then, so the last thing that we're going to look at, again, this is big. I'm going to open this module early so you can look at it over spring break because it's just a lot. But we're going to look at three big revolts, what we call slave revolts. And they're complicated. They're really, really complicated. So we're going to look at Gabriel's Conspiracy of 1800, Nat Turner's Rebellion of 1831, and the John Brown Raid on Harper's Ferry, the sort of the titles of them in 1859. And we're going to look at W.E.B. Du Bois, this idea of what kind of form do revolts take and what's sort of the attitude of an imprisoned group and what rights does an imprisoned group have that they get to revolt and have revenge, that they get to self-determine their response, that it's self-defense, that revolution and revolt is self-defense to systemic racism and oppression. Write that down. That was a good sentence. And do we buy that? Do we believe that? So what's really interesting, let me see if these links work. Gabriel's Conspiracy or is just here, right? Is number one. Number two is Nat Turner's Rebellion. And then number three is John Brown's Raid on Harper's Ferry. And this is, again, it's all in the Remini book as well, right? So just always remember the Remini book. So I'm going to give you one quick sample of a question that we would ask, and this would be for your quiz. It's going to be for you could write a paper on this. You can do this as your final project, but something that's fascinating to me is the question of, same with Margaret Garner, right? Is Nat Turner a hero or a villain? And this becomes our main sort of overarching question for these rebellions, that we might see Gabriel's conspiracy as, you know, divinely inspired. He was hearing the voices of God. So was Nat Turner. And that they felt compelled. John Brown is a white man who was just not hearing the voice of God, but he, you know, really just compelled to fight for slavery. He thought that was his life's mission, was to fight for and with African-Americans. But Nat Turner is a really complicated case because, like Margaret Garner, there's two sides to it. Well, in Margaret Garner's case, there's two ways that she was used and manipulated in the media. In Nat Turner's case, the argument becomes, is he a hero or villain? Because he ends up killing a lot of white folks. But the response to that is that twice as many African Americans get murdered in retaliation, like in response. So was it the right thing to do, right? Is Nat Turner's rebellion, and I, you know, this is just personal opinion, right, about how you believe, is Nat Turner's killing of 100 white people an important enough message and like revolt? And is it just necessary to the point that it's worth having 200 Black people, most of whom were not even fighting in the rebellion, murdered afterwards, killed afterwards? Is it worth it? Is it worth innocent lives in order to have a rebellion? And that is a question for each person to answer individually as their own historians, right? So as your historian, which side are you on? Now, the two videos I'm about to show you right now are fascinating because it's the two different ways to sort of view Nat Turner. Is he a hero or is he a villain? So here's the biography.com video. And let's just see how he's, I think this is, isn't the video in here? I thought this was the, okay, hold on. I'm going to go find the video. Okay, they used to have a video and I can't find it now. So I'm just going to give you the summary here. So on biography.com, there used to be this video and it used language like, and it still does. Nat Turner led one of the bloodiest slave revolts in America. Nat Turner hid for 6 weeks. The incident ended and it led to even harsher laws against the enslaved. People criticized him for using violence as a means of demanding change. So in certain ways, Nat Turner is being set up in one perspective, seen as someone who, heard these voices, that he maybe, heard voices, was crazy. The implication is that he had mental illness. Sorry, I have the hiccups. Too much talking. That he had mental illness, that he caused this slave revolt that ended up with people. He went and massacred. So this language choice of like massacred 100 white people. Then it ended up in stricter laws for African-Americans, double the amount of African-Americans being murdered by whites, being massacred by whites, that the fugitive slave laws got even tighter control around people, that plantations were shut down, that then it led to, husbands and wives not being able to see each other, parents not being able to see their kids, the enslaved who lived in the house that, were under sort of nicer conditions and were able to live in the big house got kicked out because people were afraid to even have Blacks in the house with them. So seeing Nat Turner from that perspective, seeing him as a real villain, really putting back the movement, really hurting the African-American rights movement. So that's one perspective. And that's a valid perspective. So here's the other perspective. And this is a video of Gab Union did a movie with a bunch of other super famous people. And here's the trailer for that movie. And it's got a very different perspective on Nat Turner.
Nat Turner is
a brilliant man. Spirit.
Way ahead of his time.
Wait. It says that my screen sharing is paused. Oh, you know what? I think I can't. It doesn't like it when I make it a big screen. No, it still says screen sharing paused. Okay. So let me go back here and try over again. It doesn't like it when I make it the whole screen. So you're just going to have to watch it small. You can go find this. You can watch it yourself too on YouTube. Okay. So now you can screen share. Okay. So
I'm Nicole Hockley from.
Remember, please take notes. This is a really important perspective that's totally opposite of Nat Turner as the villain, somebody who gave a bad rep to Black folks, who put the Black rights movement way behind by doing something so violent. So listen now to the other side.
Nat Turner is
Brilliant man.
Incredible spirit.
Way ahead of his time.
Incredibly brave. I think he's the ultimate American hero.
Nat Turner is one of the most controversial Americans in history, period. He was an enslaved preacher in 1831.
Listen to him, and you might make it into heaven.
He had been farmed out by his master to preach to neighboring plantations.
Slaves, submit yourselves to your masters with all respect, not only to those who are good and considerate, but also to those who are harsh.
This was a man who was saying, if I am to be a messenger of God, then I have to do something.
The Lord has spoken to me. Visions of what's to come. A rise of good against evil.
What are we going to do?
We'll fight.
He was somebody who was standing up for what he believed in such a pure and authentic way. And because of that, he was able to recruit a bunch of people.
Nat Turner led the most successful slave rebellion in the history of our country.
He was able to do something that was seemingly impossible. So what he achieved at that time was an act of real, true revolution.
Most people don't know Nat Turner, the history, the motivation. So I think this film is doing enormously important work. It's bringing a historical narrative that really illuminates the context of what we're going through in America today.
Beware of false prophets who come dressed in sheep's clothing, but inwardly are ravening wolves.
We don't imagine slaves to be heroes. So for the first time, I really understood what this man did.
If the Lord's called you to fight, you fight. You fight for us all.
It is important to know those parts of American history that we don't get to know, but they're also crucial to our understanding of what America is.
He sowed the seeds of rebellion. We harvested it in the abolition of slavery.
Through desegregation, through the civil rights movement, into Black Lives Matter. This Black revolutionary thought is everything that Nat Turner stood for and stands for today.
On to Jerusalem!
The story of Nat Turner is a relevant story. It is a story that makes sense to discuss in 2016.
Okay, so I'm gonna just cut it off there. And again, this is posted in your modules. You can watch the rest of this on your own time. This video is getting so long. Okay, so it's a really fascinating thing, right? So you're going from, here's this Nat Turner who massacred all these people, killed 100 people, set the movement back, caused all these problems, reinforced anti-Black legislation, too. It's the most successful slave revolt in American history. He's an American hero. He's the first American revolutionary, like totally two different sides. So in that way, again, similar to Margaret Garner, just this person who made a bold and brazen choice and became a divisive figure, right? Caused these two very, very strong arguments. And the rest of it is up to you. What do you think about this? What do you think about Nat Turner? What do you think about his revolt? Was it for the good? Was it for ill? Was it progressive? Was it bringing progress to people who otherwise had no access to progress and progressive movements? All these reform movements, are they progressive? Who are they progressive for? And I can't wait to see what you have to say. So this is in discussions and this is in your comments. And of course you get extra credit for watching the movie. And that's the norm, right? Everybody gets extra credit for watching the movie. It's in the syllabus. Just flip through the syllabus and see, go scroll down to the extra credit. We had Black History Month extra credit. And now it being March, we have Women's History Month extra credit as well. So if you were signed up for this week's read and lead, you post them here, you just put in reply, and then you do attach. The read and leads that have gone so far are doing great. So keep up the great work. And that's it. So that's your module. Here's my video for the last week. So That's it. So you're going to have a second discussion post on Nat Turner, the two sides of Nat Turner. What do you think? So again, there's Margaret Garner discussion. There's a Nat Turner discussion, and keep them short because you've got two, right? You don't need to, don't write me a 5-paragraph essay for each discussion. It's a 1-paragraph that's due. Remember, modules open Monday. Wednesday is your discussion post is due Friday. 2 peer replies. They're due by Friday, 2 peer replies. And then Sunday is when assignments or quizzes are due. This week, you don't have either. You have 2 discussion posts instead. Okay. Big week, right? Reform movement is a lot. The reform movement is a lot. We're dealing with women's rights and Black rights and drinking and just a lot of stuff is happening. And it all connects, right? The women's movement and the Black rights movement, of course, connect. And please, please, please read all of the things that I posted, Sojourner Truth, Ain't I a Woman speech, and how they intersect, right? The intersection of race and class. And watch all the links and the videos. They're all pretty relatively short. All right. Thank you so much. Thank you for paying attention and taking good notes and being really present. You've been doing great so far in the discussions and really keeping up with me in office hours and emails. And you're just a wonderful class. I'm so happy to be working with you. This is a big week. Let's really knock it out of the park. I hate baseball, but let's knock it out of the park. All right. Thank you so much. See you around. I hit the wrong button. That was screen share, not end. Bye.